Hello and welcome. I'm Tor Olivsrud, senior writer for CIO.com. With me today is May Yap, senior vice president and CIO of manufacturing services company Jabil, which has 100 plants in 30 countries. May is the winner of numerous awards, including IDC Asia Pacific's 2021 CIO of the Year Award. May, thank you so much for joining me today.
Hey, thank you, Tor. Thank you for inviting me, and a warm hello to everybody.
All right, so let's dive right in. What does future of work mean to you, May? I know you're passionate about mentoring and diversity and inclusion as fundamental elements of the future of work. What role does that play?
Yeah, thank you, Tor. So let me start a little bit by a quick introduction about Jabil, right? So you can mention that Jabil is a manufacturing solution provider, but we have 260,000 employees, over 100 locations in 35 different countries. So when you think about that, the success and the business resilience really start with the people, with our employees. So what's very key for us is that we have intentionally actually put people, talent as a very critical pillar for our overall strategy, not only for Jabil as a whole, but also for IT to ensure that, you know, the diversity of our team can actually help us to continue to foster innovations, to foster and advance our idea and offer new perspective and new ideas that create real business benefit and resilience for Jabil. So the future of work, when you think about it, right? So it is, to us, we know that, hey, it is about embracing AI, embracing analytics, embracing robotics, robots, having the robots coexisting with us, you know, when we are working and when technology actually enable the people through digitalization. So with a diverse team myself, I have about 1,700 employees throughout Jabil, and as you know, it actually kind of spread across 100 locations and 35 over country. So what's very important for me while we actually take our people through the future of work is to actually have some guiding principles, right, to actually help them navigate through this very complex time right now. So there are three fundamental principles that I'd just like to share a little bit. So the first one really deals with the mindset and the behavior, right? So, you know, we kind of guide and we advocate a lot about what I talked about in the 5 C's principle. So think about the 5 C's as in C, in terms of customer driven. So we need to be customer driven. We need to be customer focused so that every of the business issue, every of the issues that we are dealing with, we need to actually kind of relate to, you know, how does it actually help to solve a business problem? What are the business potential that we can actually bring, you know, while we actually embark on a new solution or applications? So that's the customer driven side, right? And then what's more important is that technology is changing every day. So we do need to establish a community of practice, a community of practice where we continue to learn and share, and the leadership team actually mentor our people so that we actually, you know, learn very quickly together, right? The third thing is really communication. Communicate, communicate, and communicate. So it's never enough that, hey, the strategy, the thought process, you know, what we wanted to do needs to be communicated through and penetrate through the organization. And the fourth thing I talk about in terms of the C is really the courage, right? The courage to try on new technology, the courage to want to embrace on something new, right? And unfortunately, if you fail on these new ideas, make sure that you actually quickly learn from the mistake and do not repeat that again. And try something new, right? Although I would not say that we encourage you to make many mistakes, but you really need to learn from the mistake. It's through mistake learning that you actually know how to actually improve better. And then last but not least, pardon me. So it is really about compliance. So we give zero tolerance to breach of integrity, and compliance is very important. So that's a mindset change, right? And then secondly, we talk about future-proofing the whole organization, and making sure that the solution that we provide is future-proof, right? So when we think about the talent strategy, we think about the strategic direction, the cutting-edge technology that we're going to bring to the organization. We ourselves from IT, right? We have shifted our IT role from just the traditional IT service provider to the enabler, to the strategic partner, to the leaders. It is important to let the C-suite, the leadership team within the organization knows what IT can do and what are the potential that IT can actually bring about, right? So I continue to advocate, and especially for, you know, other CIOs, that it is important that you need to actually have and win the mindset of the senior leaders, the CEO, the business unit leaders, and make sure that they really understand what IT is doing and how to partner together with IT, right? So that's about that part of the work. And then thirdly, we have expanded a lot of key talent-based initiatives, right? You talk about citizen data scientists, and we also have other programs like early career talent journey, right? Global talent transformation, mentoring the woman in tech, you know, and making sure that, you know, the hard to acquire skills in IT, we have actually put in the training platform for the people to learn. So we wanted to actually embrace and create an inclusive and future ready workforce so that we continue to learn every day. So I think the pandemic itself actually made us rethink the way that work needs to get done, right? So we have actually really enhanced this capability of human machine collaboration and created new and upgraded skill set. So all these are very important in terms of preparing the workforce for the future of work.
Okay, so a lot of Jabil's recent modernization efforts have their foundation in the Factory of the Future initiative, which I know you started several years ago. Can you explain what that initiative involves?
Yep, definitely. So, well, like what you mentioned, that's the passion of mine, right? So I really started the Factory of the Future journey quite a few years ago, right? So at that time when we actually set up this Factory of the Future, we actually did not actually have a big fancy name. We call it Factory Optimization. So the sole intention is that, hey, I wanted to optimize the factory. And slowly we actually evolve, right? Evolve to, you know, I will talk about the entire ecosystem that we are talking when we talk about Factory of the Future. So the evolution itself actually start thinking where I actually put in place the thought process that, hey guys, right? So in the field, in the factory itself, we do need to have an approach on how we actually move forward to this Factory of the Future. So very clearly for me, I actually kind of work with the operation team and we take in a what we call a DBO approach, right? We digitalize. Once we can digitalize something in the factory, then we can visualize it. When we can visualize it, right? And you have the data because you digitalize it. Now you can see it. Then we can really think about how to optimize the processes within the factory. So that's the DBO approach that we have actually, you know, set forward for ourselves when we actually march towards the Factory of the Future journey. And then when we talk about the Factory of the Future, right? So what's very important for me is that the IT team takes an important role to establish the entire Factory of the Future ecosystem. And when I talk about ecosystem, right, that really talks about, hey, I need to put in place a very robust infrastructure backbone for the factory, right? So the infrastructure and the foundation is important for growth and transformation within the factory. So that is the core competency that IT needs to establish and put in place in the factory. So that's about the infrastructure backbone. And we talk about all the production system that we need to use, right? So Jabil, we have been using MES since the day that Jabil started. So along the way, the system needs to be modernized. So another very big part of what IT needs to do and is doing today is continue to modernize the system that we use in the factory, the MES system, the PLM system, right? The SPC system, the tool management, the quality system, etc. So those are the things that we continue to modernize so that we can actually explore and exploit the differentiating capabilities of what Jabil has into all this, you know, what I call the production system. So then the other part of it is that, you know, once you have system, once you actually put in place the system, you connected the factory within you connected the machine within the factory, we have a lot of data that come out, right? Mm-hmm. So how do you use the data? So the next thing is really, you know, teaching the people how to leverage on the data, making sure that we create a foundational layer of what I call the data lake to make sure that data is accessible to everybody, right? So that's the data part. And then having data is not good enough, right? Having data is just like having bits and bytes. So it is really transforming data to information, to knowledge. So that process itself also takes a lot of effort for us to actually handhold the user to make sure that, hey, they can really use the data and leverage the data, and we guide them on how to use this data to actually analyze problem to the later stage as using data to actually solve problem and using data to actually move forward to creating AI models, right? So that's also very big in our factory today. And while we have data, while we have system, it is very important that we do need to protect the environment. So you definitely cannot miss the part about the protection and the cybersecurity and making sure that all these are actually well established. And the other big component of the entire ecosystem is that, you know, while we actually make sure that things are put in place, it's also very important that we continue to work with our operation team, with our supply chain team, to continue to look at processes, make it simpler, right? Make it simpler, standardize them, and then automate them, automate such processes through, you know, robotic processes, automations. And then we actually work very closely also with the automation team, with engineering team, to actually put in place automation works, right? Things like AGVs into the factory. So in a nutshell, that's what I call the entire ecosystem or factory of the future.
Okay. So when you get down to it, the Factory of the Future initiative focuses on future-proofing manufacturing, which you brought up earlier. As you said, that's a passion of yours. I'm wondering if you can tell us more about what that involves.
Absolutely. So future-proofing is definitely the North Star for IT, right? So for me, I actually envision an environment, a factory of the future environment where IT, ET, OT effectively coexist together, right? Where we actually deliver together to actually bring the operation stability into the factory. Right. So I think people are familiar with IT for sure. OT is really the operation technology. And we talk about engineering, right? Engineering are involved and engineering have their technology too. So that's why I term the ET, right? So it's where IT, ET, OT actually work together seamlessly to actually bring the equivalent into the factory. So a very typical illustration, right, of that is actually creating the digital thread across the manufacturing value chain. So when we talk about the digital thread, think about it as in, you know, in the whole manufacturing life cycle, right? So there are times where, you know, we need to actually have the digital defines the future. Think about it. So digital defining the future, that's really where it turns out the physical drawing or physical product into CAD drawings, right? So that we can actually start to actually have the CAD drawing and start doing the manufacturing. So that's when digital actually define the physical. And then you also have digital managing the physical, right? That's the PLM system that we have put in place, right? And then in the manufacturing shop floor, you have the digital twin, right? So once we connect machines, we have a lot of telemetry data, right? So with all this data, it is very easy for me to actually create the digital twin of all the machineries that we have, right? The digital assets that's actually put in place. And there's a lot of good value that we are trying out with the digital assets that we have, right? Because we have the telemetry of the machines. We actually know when the machine is up, when the machine is down. So there's a lot of matrix that actually comes with it, right? So for me, what I really wanted to do is to come to a state where, hey, a lot of my NPI, the new product introduction, we don't have to actually, you know, do it with physical machines only, right? That's where the digital assets can actually come in, the past data that you have collected on this asset can actually helps you to do a lot of simulation model for MPI. So that's one use case that we have. And then the other use case is really, hey, everybody talks about predictive maintenance, right? So how do you actually do it? When you think about predictive maintenance, so when we actually have, you know, the digital asset, the digital telemetry, the digital, you know, birth certificate or everything that's happening on that machine itself, right? So we can actually link it to our, what we call the asset management system to actually understand, you know, the machine is, when we look at the digital asset, we see that the machine is down. Do we know why is it down? Why is it not operating, right? So is it because it is scheduled for normal maintenance or it is down because it's down, right? So we wanted to actually kind of link all this data point from SAP, from our asset management tool to actually kind of do a match and understand the behavior of the machine itself, right? So when we actually understand more about the behavior, that's when predictive maintenance can really kick in, Okay. So that's what I talk about in terms of digital threat. And then the other aspect, right, that I'm talking about is really the advocacy of the adoption of cloud and data. And we think through this, right, and the mission that I've set up for data, right, is that what I really want data, and the reason why we collect data, is I really want the data to speak to us so that we can actually have the data to act for us. So that's this concept that I actually advocate when we actually talk about data, right? It's really let data act, let data speak first, and then let data act. So those are two of the very important premises that we are actually pushing forward in terms of Factory of the Future.
All right. Now, you mentioned that it's not enough to just pull data off your manufacturing lines, right? You need to actually gain insight from that data. And I know that early on in this process, Jabil struggled to find data scientists to help them with that process, which ultimately led to your citizen data science program. Can you tell me more about that program and how it works?
Definitely. So I think you hit on a few key points, right? So we struggle to find data scientists, and I think it is not unique in Jabil itself. So I think they are very, very difficult to come by resources, right? And then this particular skill gap and talent demand is just not unique to us. And it reflects the importance of the role of big data in all the industry, right? So that's why we actually created the Citizen Data Science Program. So the thinking logic behind Citizen Data Science Program is that we do actually want our people, right? And I'm talking about our users, our IT users from functions, from the business line, from the operation, people who are dealing with data day in and day out. And they actually know the best on what to do with this data. So with that in mind, we actually created this Citizen Data Science Program to actually give them a very systematic approach to actually learn about data and learn about data science and equip them with the skill sets of doing the AI model. So that's really the premise of that, right? So it takes a while to actually identify who is the right candidates, right? Because we do want the right people to actually come into the data science program. It is a certified program. It is a 6-month course where they will actually go through formal education to actually empower them with the skill sets. And then with that, they need to actually bring about, you know, a real business problem that they are facing and actually solve it throughout the 6 months. So it's with this process, we actually ensure that, hey, you know, whatever they learn, they actually practice it immediately. So that was really the intention of what we wanted to do. But what's more important is that while we actually do this data science program, we have more and more people actually now appreciating about data, right? So which I'm very pleased, because my intention is really, you know, to teach people how to fish instead of just fishing it for them, right? So we put a lot of attention teaching them and then educating them, equipping them. So it has come to a good maturity right now where our users, right, are really encouraged to be the smart IT user. They are able to create their own visualization report and make the analytics and make the analysis through there. Because like what I mentioned, they deal with the data day in, day out. They know best on how to actually work on this data and really get the insights from the data.
All right. Now, I know that Jabil has worked closely with several universities to stand up this citizen data science program. Which universities have you partnered with, and why have those partnerships been so important to the success of the program?
Yeah, definitely. So, you know, the data science program is actually rolled throughout the whole world, right? So we have actually partnered with university in our headquarters with University of Florida, right? South Florida Academy, right? And then that's one major hub that we have. And we have people in China, we have people in Singapore, we have people in Penang. So those are all the major hubs that we have. So in all those locations, we have partnered with the best university to actually introduce the data science program, right? For example, in Singapore, we partner with the National University of Singapore to actually introduce the data science program, right? So likewise, in Malaysia, we partner with USM to actually do that. So the university partnership itself is that we choose and actually partner with universities that actually understand the manufacturing environment. So what's very key for me is that we do need to have our partner, our training partners, who understand and appreciate how data is being used in the manufacturing world, right? So I think that's a very key important success, and they're committed to actually help us groom our people, and they are knowledgeable about the subject. So in the program itself, we also introduce a lot of use cases, right? Mm-hmm. We get the university to actually tell us more about the use cases that they see. What are some of the refined, revised use cases that continue to come up in the manufacturing world and outside the manufacturing world, so that we can actually open the mind of our attendees so that they actually know that, wow, they're amazed by what the power of data can do for them. So that's very, very important for me. And that's what I look out when we actually talk about the university partnership.
Right. So you mentioned this, and it really stood out for me as something that makes this this program really unique, and that's its relentless focus on business problems. Right. As you said, anyone within Jabil who wants to go through the program has to come with a business problem they want to solve. And I was wondering if you could tell us more about that and why it's been so key to the program's success.
Yeah, definitely. Right. So think about it, right? If we do not bring in a real business problem that they're dealing with day in and day out, it becomes a very academic exercise, to be honest. Right? It becomes, you know, just another use case. It's just something that they cannot relate to. So it is very fundamental that, hey, they need to actually be thinking through, right? Everything that they are learning step by step, how does that actually relate to my everyday life? How does that actually relate to what I need to do, right? And how can I take that knowledge back from what I learned and into my work function immediately? So that's the connection that we wanted to make here, right? And these are very important things that they are solving every day, right? Because I talk about, you know, they are the people that deal with data. So to step back a little bit, not everybody can come into this data science program, right? So we really want the manager to actually put their thoughts through, to actually nominate the right people to actually attend the class, right? And the right people, like what I mentioned, they have to be dealing with data. We can actually be nominating the senior leaders to actually come in to learn about programming, to learn about Python, to learn about, you know, looking through and cut and dice the data, because you know they will not do that, right? In practicality, they will not do that. It would be good if they are interested in it, but they will not be the one doing the job. So that's why, you know, bring the real business problem actually helps to hone in and encourage them to continue to use this knowledge after the course.
All right. And can you give us some examples of some business problems that have been brought to the program?
Right. So the spectrum of the business problem, right, actually relates to the people who have actually come in to join the program, right? So over the years, we do actually have, you know, all facets and people coming from different functions, ranging from the finance team, right, the quality team, the operation team themselves, the supply chain team. So you can imagine the spectrum of the problems that they have actually brought in are actually very wide ranging, right? So the finance team are very concerned with the financial KPIs, things like, you know, cash flow prediction. So those are the problems that they have actually brought in. Really, really interesting, right? So cash flow prediction, what are the key parameters that will actually affect cash flow? Right. So while they actually collect all this data, things like, you know, how do we do our accounts payable? Right. How do we actually, you know, how quickly can we turn around the cash? So those are the data point that they will start to analyze for them to actually build out a model on cash flow analysis. So that's on the finance side. Right. So the supply chain side, you know, supply chain has a lot of data. Right. So the data actually relates to, you know, for example, in the shop floor itself, we always deal with material and the flow of the material. How do we actually rightly, you know, understand the demand forecasting from the customer coming in, and how does that actually match our MRP, right? So that we have many use cases around that too, right? So that's from the supply chain and the operation team. And then, you know, to the very extreme, right, we also talk about, you know, because we know that a very key case study that application of AI and advanced analytics is visual inspection, augmenting the visual inspection by AI algorithm. So we have a few of those use cases that was brought in to actually think about that, right? So we have many inspection and inspection jobs in the factory itself. So can AI model actually use to augment those, you know, inspector, physical, you know, human inspector itself? So yeah, so in a nutshell, that's a wide range of use cases right there.
All right. So you know, considering all of those different perspectives that are being brought into the program, I mean, it seems like some of the other elements that have been cited as part of the success of the Citizen Data Science Program are that it brings together cross-functional teams, and also the creation of a shorter training program for an executive level cohort. You mentioned that you don't necessarily want to get executives into the weeds, but I understand that there is a training program for executives that helps them get a better idea of what this Citizen Data Science Program can accomplish. I'm wondering how those elements have contributed to the program's success.
Very much so. I think having these senior leaders and the executive leaders really understand data and understand the power of data, right? And the complexity it goes through when we actually do such program and, you know, the modeling itself is very, very important, because they now understand when we talk about the definition of data, they can actually have a better appreciation. When we talk about the AI model, they actually understand that, hey, you know, you can't just get the results immediately. It needs time to actually train the model. So all this thing will actually help to set the expectation right. And then the use cases that we talk about, right? So many times during those executive data science programs, one thing that we really want to wow the executive is that, hey guys, look at what other people are doing. Look at how AI, look at how data can actually change, you know, change the processes or change the way that we operate, right? So it is those kind of wow factors that I really want to create in them and make them feel that, hey, you know, I'm also an advocate of data. Hey, I also wanted to be part of this data journey, right? So I think that's a very, very key for success factor. And I can still remember, right? So we actually go through a 2 days awareness training for our, you know, one of the business sector CEO, right? The CEO actually put in all his, you know, direct reports into the awareness class. And we talk about, hey, what happened to the machine? You know, when we collect the data from the machine, we actually start to see that, hey, there are parameters that we know that's going to affect the output, the quality of the product that we do, right? For example, the temperature coming out from the injection molding, the pressure, you know, the shipping pressure itself. So he remembers that. And now he can talk to me and say, hey, how is the temperature affecting that parameter? How is this actually affecting that? So it is a mindset change that we are trying to create within the executive itself, so that they actually embrace it and then they understand it. And more importantly, they are there to support their team members when, you know, when they come forward and say, hey, I wanted to actually embark on this project. I wanted to actually take on some of this data science project. They understand what needs to be done.
All right. So May, just to close this out, do you have any insight or advice for your peers who, you know, are looking at how to start thinking about modernizing their organizations?
Definitely. So I think it's a journey, right? Modernizing, or what I call the digital transformation, is definitely a journey. And one thing for sure, I think the learning lesson for us is that the IT cannot do it all, right? We need to actually work collaboratively with the business functions, with the operation team, with all the stakeholders to actually move this forward. And it's when we work collaboratively, we become one team that actually collectively wanted to improve the well-being of the organization. We wanted to improve and make, you know, digital transformation and digitalization a very key differentiator for the company. I think with that mindset, I think that's something that I wanted to actually leave with the team.
Okay. May, thank you so much for speaking with me today. This has been great.
Thank you. Thank you, Paul.
For IDG and CIO.com, I'm Toril of Srud. Thanks for watching.